coming out. This is just such a delight to see all of you, and so many of you who have participated in the biennial and made it all possible by being our venues and connected with the galleries, and of course the incredibly talented photographers. I want to especially thank a few people, Sam Miller, who organizes everything and keeps it running straight.
You're welcome, Mom.
Elizabeth Spaulding, who designed the website and the program guide, which we really love. And I hope you can see her right now. She and her husband are on their way back from Paris, and they're trying to get, they were trying to get here, but I don't know if the plane made it on time or not. And Julie Schweitzer, who has organized a she and Kim Wilhite are responsible for the Paste Up Mural project that's going on that is brightening up some walls around Louisville and southern Indiana as a good way to cross market. Also, of course, the volunteers who have helped us out so much in a lot of different aspects, because it's a cooperative effort, and the individual people who lend their time and efforts and expertise have been incredibly important to us. And this, of course, includes our board of directors and Marvin Young, who is doing a video of this, who's on our board, has donated his time and expertise as well. So all that time and the talent and the dedication are what make this possible for our 53 venues now that are participating in the photo biennial. So also, of course, I want to thank the Speed for making this space available to us and donating the time and the people and the expertise, and of course the marketing support, which has brought the word to so many people to come out tonight and listen to Larry Shore, who you're just going to enjoy to no end, because he has great stories about everybody. With the Speed, of course, I want to thank Rafael Apedo, who is the director, and Dean Otto, who is going to come up in just a minute to introduce Larry. Dean and Larry worked together a number of years ago, and it was through Dean that I was able to contact Larry, and this all came about. So I'll turn it over now to Dean, who will come over.
To the Louisville Photo Biennial and our keynote presentation by the photographer, author, producer, director, and major chronicler of the of popular culture, Lauren Schiller. My connection to Larry goes back to the early 1990s when I began to work at the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis. My mentor, the curator of film video, Bruce Jenkins, had organized a touring retrospective of the films of Dennis Hopper in the late 1980s, and the four remaining 16 millimeter prints of L.M. Kit Carson and Larry Schiller's film, The American Dreamer, were donated to the museum's film collection. No other film prints remained, as the negative for that film was lost in a fire earlier. Over the next two decades, I was in contact with Larry often, as many film retrospectives and museums and cinematheques all over the world requested that film. In the late 2000-aughts, the prints were in tough shape as the color had faded from many of the 16mm prints, and a video transfer was made of the very best elements of those prints. And when funding came through to digitize the collection, and digital color restoration technology had advanced considerably, the prints were scanned, and we worked over the course of nearly 3 years to restore the American Dreamer. Larry traveled to the lab to advise on the color correction using stills that he had shot on location during the production of the film, and the restoration premiered at the Walker Art Center in October of 2014, and we will be screening that restoration of the American Dreamer here at the Speed Cinema on Sunday at 12:30 for free, so I hope you can make that. Well, after I moved to Louisville, during one of the first Friday art crawls prior to the pandemic, I visited Paul Paletti in his gallery, and he gave me a tour of his collection. We ended up in his office, where he showed me a contact sheet of Marilyn Monroe on the set of Something's Got to Give, which was made by Larry Schiller, and which is also discussed in Schiller's book, Marilyn and Me, a memoir in words and photographs. It was then we discussed the possibility of bringing Larry to Louisville, and please visit Paul's gallery on Market Street, where the exhibition, Famous, Lawrence Schiller, is on view through September 29th. Well, the pandemic stymied the possibility for a few years, but I'm so glad that we have Larry here tonight to discuss his career, incredible connections to major cultural moments of the 20th century, and to some of the most iconic figures in popular culture and literature. He's won an Oscar for his documentary, The Man Who Skied Down Everest, and his television films, The Executioner's Song and Peter the Great, won 5 Emmys. I don't believe you brought any of those Oscars or Emmys with you tonight, too. But please join me in welcoming the multi-talented Lawrence Schiller here to the Louisville Photo Biennial.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much. As I look across this audience of supporters of contemporary photography and of the museum, I do see something tremendously lacking in this audience. You see, when I started the Norman Mailer Center after Norman passed on in 2008, we had a rule that you could not have an event without somebody who was over 25 years of age bringing somebody who was younger than 18 years of age. And I don't see any young people in this audience. And if you want to use people like me, which I'm here, and others to inspire the generations to come, whether it's social media or not, you need to reach out to your community, family, friends. So the next time we have an event, and you have an event, well, let's see 20% of this audience being young people. I have a PowerPoint here to kind of trigger my memory, because I'm just 16 going on 87, and sometimes I need these little things to trigger. So this is a picture taken in the 50s. I don't know who the photographer was. The young fellow selling film is me. My father had just given me a camera. I was about 14 years old. And I got very much interested in photographing reflections on mirrors. I would put water and it'd make it look kind of funny and things like that. And I had this opportunity at the San Diego County Fair, where I was raised, to help sell film. But my mother was scared, so she sent my grandmother over there to babysit me. And that's my grandmother babysitting me over there. You see? So, I had a camera. And when you're very, very young, there are certain things that interest you and start to develop you, good or bad or indifferent. In those days, the police radio band, police signals, was at the end of the FM radio band. So if you had AM and you had FM, as we had an FM radio, you could listen to the police radio signals. And even though they used codes in those days, you could figure out when there was an automobile accident. And I used to get on my bicycle during the week, and I would ride to the closest automobile accident. But by the time I would get there, the cars were towed away. If somebody had been injured, that was off to the hospital, and the police had left. So what did I wind up photographing was skid marks. Now, this is a very, very important thing in my life, because what I didn't realize over a period of years, and by the way, if my dad was home on Saturdays or Sundays, mostly Sundays, because he worked on Saturdays, and he wasn't too upset, he'd drive me to an accident. But what I started to learn without realizing I was learning was lighting, backlighting, lighting at night, shooting into the sun. How do you produce something? And I one time showed the pictures to my dad and some friends, and my dad said, well, you know, here in California, you can get a driver's permit when you're 16 years old, and if you can earn enough money with your camera for half the cost of a car, I'll pay for the other half. So I don't remember who said it to me, but somebody said, well, why don't you sell your pictures to the insurance companies, because pictures tell a story. That's the first time in my life I heard somebody say to me, pictures tell a story, and skid marks tell a story of an accident. So I'd go down to the police station on my bicycle after school, and I'd ask to look at the police report for a certain accident, and I'd find out the insurance company, and I would sell the pictures for $6. And believe it or not, within 2.5 years, I had sold $3,000 some odd in pictures, which allowed for half the price of a Ford that I bought. And that starts to tell a very important story about me. Because if there is something to be obtained, you have to figure a way of doing it. I went to La Jolla High School, and La Jolla High School was a very, very fine school in San Diego, California, and it had a lot of important athletes living in the community. Gene Littler, those that play golf, was a major golf figure, and he lived there. Flo Chadwick had just swam the English Channel, the first woman to ever do it. Mo Conley had just won Wimbledon in the Nationals. So I started to shoot sports pictures. And I had a 4x5 speed graphic with a focal plane shutter. Well, by the time you hit the button for the shutter, you know, the picture's all over. And what I had to do was learn anticipation. And that's the second most important thing in my life, is not only the anticipation when you're taking pictures, but the anticipation of what might happen next in life. What might happen if you are going too fast around the corner with your car. This is Monty Upshaw at La Jolla High School breaking Jesse Owens' 21-year record in the broad jump. But this is an example of a picture with a 4x5 speed graphic that has a focal plane shutter that has much delay in it with a 10-inch lens. But also in La Jolla, there was what is known as the La Jolla Beach and Club Tennis. And the first people I ever worked for, and I would send them some pictures, was International Tennis Magazine. And my knowledge of learning anticipation allowed me to do extraordinary tennis pictures that I didn't even realize at that time had a certain grace or feel to it. I was just trying to anticipate the moment. And this will give you an example. Now, when you realize this is taken with a big 4x5 speed graphic with a lens that's sticking out like this, you had to really start to understand. So in the early days when I went to high school, I really studied anticipation, and I was learning lighting. And I was very fortunate with my sports pictures that the LA Herald Examiner gave the Scholastic Sports Awards. And it was a 4-year scholarship to college. When I graduated high school, I had a D- average in every one of my classes. Now, why did I have a D- average? Well, I didn't realize, because the word didn't exist at that time, that I was dyslexic. I could not read. I was always flunking classes. I could not concentrate on reading more than a paragraph in a school paper or a book. And of the 7 or 8 scholarships I had, the only school that would take me with bad grades was Pepperdine College. Pepperdine only had 800 students at that time. And when Governor Goodwin J. Knight came to school there to give a speech, I had already been studying Yusuf Karsha's lighting and Fleep Halsman's spontaneousness, and I did this picture of Goodwin J. Knight, which became his official portrait when I'm in high school. Now, what did that do to me? It gave me a big head. And in some ways, this picture was a positive thing and sometimes a negative. That's what I looked like when I got a Rolleiflex. And again, there's something very interesting of me holding this camera. Is I'm not using the reflex. I never used the reflex. I'm using the rangefinder because to me, I needed to anticipate and to see the real thing happening. This is the first picture that I ever really published besides tennis pictures. And when I was in college, I was shooting tennis all over the world. I really went to school only 3 or 4 days to school. And at Pepperdine, which is a very religious school, I never wanted to show up in the Bible study class, you know, and so forth. But the short and long of it was, the most important thing in those days was to be in Life magazine. The most important thing was to have a cover of Life magazine. Life magazine sold 4 million copies, 3 million on the newsstands alone. And every single photographer in the world, their dream is to publish in Life magazine. So I had to dream up something, and I was actually dating a tennis player by the name of Barbara Bright, who was the Wimbledon doubles junior tennis player. And that's her on the left leaning over as this guy is repairing the car in Pacific Beach. But if you really look closely, you will see that it's a dummy upside down, and there's a beer can holding him up that's propped against. You see? And Life ran this full page at the end of the magazine called Head Over Heels in Work. This was my first picture in Life magazine. And of course, the first picture in Life magazine, when somebody sees something unusual, they start to call you. Now, I had a problem. I had lots of ideas. And I would write letters to magazines all over the world. In the U.S., everybody with an idea. I lived in L.A., and there were celebrities, movie stars, events, you know, athletes, the Olympics were coming to L.A., and all of that. And I was getting reject after reject after reject letter. And I used to pin them up, some of them, in the bathroom, so as I sat on the water closet, I could study why am I getting these rejects. And then I realized the mistake I was making. One of the most important things I put in there was, I'm only 19 years old. And I realized that nobody was going to hire a 19-year-old photographer. So I started sending the same ideas to other magazines without my age, and I started getting assignments. This is an assignment I got from the New York Times magazine. because I wrote them a letter and said, you know, I watched the McCarthy hearings in the newsreel, and Joe Welch is going to be in a movie, I read, with Otto Preminger directing, and I'd like to go photograph Joe Welch as this great lawyer who now plays a judge. Well, that's me there on the left-hand side photographing Joe Welch. But this assignment shaped my entire life. And I'll tell you why. Because every day, while we were waiting for the cameraman to set up, and there was a great life photographer there, Jean Mealy, and other people covering this movie, Anatomy of a Murder, Otto Preminger, I was the youngest, Otto Preminger kind of said to me one day, you want to know something, Larry? If you're going to be successful in life, you better learn to surround yourself with people that are better than you, more talented than you, and know more than what you know. And that shaped my life, because as time went on, I would give up my entire salary in directing a movie to bring the right cinematographer for the film that was more talented than I would ever be. Otto Preminger, in many, many ways, shaped my life. This is the first color picture that I had in Life magazine. There was no Photoshop in those days. And when this picture appeared, everybody, photographers used to say, how'd you make that picture? Yes, there's a shadow of each of them. This is actually copied right out of the magazine. That's why the gutter is there. How did you get all of them this and that? This is on a 4x5 sheet of film. Well, if you really understand photography, the horizon can be anywhere in the world. The horizon in which Julie Newmar from Little Abner is standing on is 6 feet high. And there are trampolines all around, you see, and ladders that you don't see. And with a metronome, tick, tock, tick, tock, we would rehearse and the dancers would jump on the trampolines or jump off the ladders until I got it the way I wanted it. Of course, Polaroid film helped a little bit. I made some tests. Of course, it wasn't long until Playboy comes into your life. Tell me who in the 50s and 60s didn't all of a sudden discover Playboy, good, bad, or indifferent. So this is Joan Staley, the first Playboy playmate that I did. And she was older than me, and I was still under 21 years of age. And Hefner had to get my parents to sign a document that I would be allowed to publish the pictures under my name because I was under 21. It wasn't long until I got an assignment from Look magazine to photograph the French Marie Chevalier. Who was that? That was Yves Montand, the new Marie Chevalier. And I went out to 20th Century Fox, and when I got the telegram in those days from Paris Match, it didn't say to me that Marilyn Monroe was in the movie. It just said, we want you to photograph Yves Montand. When I got out there, I discovered that Marilyn Monroe was in the movie. So Johnny Cook, the PR guy, took me out there to meet Marilyn Monroe. And as we walked in the soundstage, and the short and long of it is, she was in black leotards, and she was walking up the steps of her dressing room. And Johnny Cook grabbed me by the hand and said, Marilyn, oh, this is Larry from Look magazine. Well, she swung around, not because of Larry, but because of Look magazine. Because the magazines in those days were what gave all the studios, you know. And she put out her hand, and she said, I'm Marilyn. Well, I got to tell you, I didn't know what to do. So then what did I do? I don't know where it came from. I responded and said, oh, I'm the big bad wolf. That's exactly what I said. And she looked at me, and she said, you don't look that bad, but when you grow up, you're really going to be bad. Marilyn could always come up with something, as you'll find out. So this is the first roll of film, and Marilyn had approval of the pictures, and those are her X marks on it. And there's a story behind this, because when she got in the dressing room and sat down, I was still scared. It was Marilyn Monroe. Yes, I had photographed Tuesday Weld, but she wasn't a big movie star. Marilyn Monroe was, you know, like almost a semi-goddess in those days, in the early 60s. This is 1960. So I started photographing her in the mirror, as you can see, with Gladys, her hairdresser. And Marilyn saw me in the mirror, and she talked into mirror at me. She says, "You're never going to get a good picture there. But if you go over and sit in the corner, you may get a good picture of me." So I sheepishly got up and went, sat in the corner, and she turned over her shoulder, and that was the first real picture that I ever made of Marilyn Monroe. And this was eventually exhibited at Cannes and so forth. What I knew then, or I discovered then, was Marilyn knew more about lighting and posing than probably most of the photographers who photographed her, because she'd been photographed for so many people for so many years since World War II that she knew exactly what a good picture of her would be like. So this in 1960 is the first time I really met a celebrity. Of course, Yves Montand I had to photograph because that's what the assignment was. So this is Yves Montand here, who later I would photograph several times. I went on to do many assignments for a French magazine called Paris Match. Why was Paris Match hiring me, a French magazine? They didn't have a photographer in Los Angeles where all the celebrities were. They had a great, great photographer in New York City who covered politics and this and that. So I became Paris Match's photographer. And this is Sophia Loren, the night she won the Academy Awards for Little Women with Carlo Ponte. And I would photograph her many times. Excuse me. In 1960 still, we had an election. And Paris Match assigned me to photograph the next president of the United States. That's what the telegram said from Paris Match. But who did all of Europe thought was the next president of the United States? Richard Nixon. Not this young, rich kid from Boston who's a Catholic and no American population will ever elect a Catholic, I was told by Paris Match. So I spent 6 weeks with Nixon. And this is a picture taken by Henri Dumont, who recently passed on, a friend of mine, in Hyannis, of all the Kennedy people watching Nixon concede to JFK at 3 o'clock in the morning at the Ambassador Hotel in LA. Of course, this is my picture of the tear dropping from Pat's eye, which won Picture of the Year and all the awards that year of Nixon with his smile. I would go on to photograph Nixon for many years with Pat Brown when he ran for governor and so forth. Marilyn Monroe comes back in my life in 1962 again. I'm doing many, many assignments. I'm traveling all over the world. Judy, my wife at that time, is furious at me. I'm never home to have dinner with the kids. My son Mark is here. He'll raise his hand and tell you, all right. And, you know, to me, getting somewhere and having an experience was the most important thing. For some reason, experiences in life was what it was all about. So Paris Match gives me an assignment to photograph Marilyn Monroe in a movie called Something's Gotta Give. Well, at that time, the studios were starting to realize how important magazine stories were. So they would do anything to have a magazine cover, a magazine photographer cover. So I went up to Marilyn's house one day with the script, with her PR person, Pat Newcomb, and we went through the script, because you're not going to be on the set, Paris Match is paying me $100 a day rate against space rates, and I'm not going to be there for 3 months, and you pick the scenes that are going to look the best in photographs. So we go through the scenes, and she says, oh, I like this one with Wally Cox. And I said, Wally Cox doesn't mean anything. Well, he means a lot to me, she said. Then we get to this scene, and she says, well, what about Splish Splash? I said, well, that's the scene where you jump in the swimming pool, and you have a nude bathing suit on, so it looks like you have no clothes on. And Dean Martin and Sid Charisse are up in the balcony on the set. Josh Logan, I think, was the director. And looking down on you. And she says, yeah, that's what the scene's supposed to be about. But you know, I'm having a big fight with the studio. They're still only paying me $125,000 a year, she says, while Liz Taylor is making Cleopatra right now and getting $1 million plus 10% of the gross. She says, I want to wipe Liz Taylor and Richard Burton off the cover of every magazine in the world. And I said, well, she says, what happens if I jump in the swimming pool with the bathing suit on, Larry, but I come out with nothing? And I looked at her. I said, Marilyn, you got a big, big problem. What's the problem? The problem is you're already famous. Now you're going to make me famous. And she looked at me and said, don't be so cocky, Larry. I can fire you in 2 seconds. And of course, on May 23rd, with her coach, Strasberg, I started to cover Marilyn. And this is an example of, you know, what I call real photojournalism. It tells you several stories within a picture. And of course, she jumped in the swimming pool with her bathing suit and came out with nothing. And Billy Woodfield, the photographer for Globe Photos, was there, and I was there. And as my daughter said a number of years later, Suzanne, here's a picture that says everything but doesn't show anything. And, you know, I had the cover of Life magazine with the set of pictures. By then, I'd already had like 5 or 6 covers of Life. And then when she passed on a few months later and I was with her the morning that she died, I had the cover of her, for lack of a better, the issue, Memories of Marilyn. So even though you grab on to an event, as I said to Marilyn, you're going to make me famous, the pictures are still with me, even though I think they're far from the best pictures I ever took. What were they, basically? They were pictures in which I really anticipated the moment again. Anticipation. Most of all my pictures were shot with a 180mm sonar lens, and so forth. And of course, I was asked to cover the funeral at Westwood Cemetery. And this is a picture that I made of DiMaggio and his son, which ran in Life, Double Page, and all the magazines throughout the world. That takes place in 1962. By 1963, I'm doing more and more assignments. I have a little studio on Sunset Boulevard in which I'm doing advertising for Lady Ellen pin curlers, for those that remember Lady Ellen, and things like that. And one of the assignments I get is to photograph Madame New, who's in the United States. And while she is in LA, after she goes to church in Beverly Hills, it comes out over the radio that her relative has been assassinated in Vietnam by the CIA. And she was known as the Dragon Lady. And Madame New, basically, was a woman without a country, because the new regime in Vietnam wasn't about ready to pay her hotel bill at the Beverly Wilshire. So all the photographers rushed to the Beverly Wilshire Hotel. And everybody's trying to get to the 9th floor, the 8th floor, whatever floor the suites are on. And I look at everybody else and I say, I don't want to be just another monkey standing in line. So I called Judy, my wife at that time, and I said, would you bring me a suitcase with some clothes in it? And I can put some of my cameras in the suitcase. And call the Beverly Wilshire Hotel and make a reservation for Larry Schiller, who's arriving from Chicago in a few hours. And what happened is she brought me the suitcase, and I just went to the deck with my suitcase, checked in, paid the money for the room for one night, was allowed to go up the elevator when nobody, the guards were all over there, and they took me to the 11th floor, and I walked down the stairs from the 11th to the 9th, and I saw the Secret Service guy at the end of the hall, Bill Eliscu, who became a friend of mine, and I went up to Bill Eliscu, and I said, I'd like to see Madam New. He says, well, you have an appointment? I said, no. He says, why are you here? I said, because I got enough money to pay her hotel bill. He went inside, and he came back out, and at that time, I was also working for the Saturday Evening Post, and he says, Madam New will see you. And I came inside, and I said, Madam New, you know, obviously, this tragedy, the whole world wants to hear your story. Manfred Kreiner of Stern Magazine is in L.A., and he's a friend of mine. I work for Stern in Germany. I'm willing to offer you $25,000 right now for an interview with Manfred. I didn't speak to Manfred. I didn't speak to Stern. I didn't have $25,000 in my bank account. And she said, for $25,000, I'll do the interview. Then I called Manfred, and I said, it's going to cost $25,000. He said, done deal. And I have the pictures. And then the next thing is, she's on an airplane to go to the Vatican, where her brother was a bishop, and the Vatican was giving her safe haven. And I go to the LAX airport and get on the same plane as her. And the plane is Scandinavian Airlines, changing planes in Stockholm. And on a napkin, I write an exclusive contract with Madam New for $50,000 for the Saturday Evening Post. I didn't have $50,000, but I knew that Hank Walker would never say no to an exclusive cover story with Madam New. And in essence, I went to Rome with her. The picture taken in Beverly Hills 2 weeks later winds up at the cover of Paris Match. And I'm not going to bore you with all the pictures. But that's an example of when you have something in your hand, sometimes you have to gamble. And sometimes my gambles didn't pay off, but most of the times they did. Because I discovered something else at that period of time in my life. That exclusivity was not what gave you the story. What gave you the story was your ability to get in, to do interviews properly, and to get the closest to the truth of what the story was all about. All money did was get me exclusivity, but it didn't get me the story. I come back, and then, by the way, this takes place the first week in November of 1963. I come back from the Vatican, where Madam New said to me when we were about ready to meet the Pope, she turned to me and said, remember, Larry, in God we trust, but not God's representatives. I don't know if she was referring to the Pope or who, but that was one of the things that she said to me. So I come back to California, and I'm home about a week. This is the middle towards the end of November. And I'm taking a shower one day, and Judy runs in screaming, Kennedy's been shot, Kennedy's been shot. I got out of the car, out of the shower, grabbed my cameras. I don't even remember getting dressed. I certainly didn't take a towel. I got in the car to drive to LAX airport. And all I thought about driving to that airport was this was retaliation for the CIA killing Ngo Dinh Phu in Vietnam. I was thoroughly convinced that Kennedy has been killed because the CIA. Well, when I got to the airport, Walter Cronkite was already broadcasting. And believe it or not, LAX was the closest airport to Dallas. Chicago's far enough further away. San Francisco is. New York is, Atlanta was no longer, wasn't yet a news organization city. And believe it or not, the press from LA was able to get to Dallas and the police station before Lee Harvey Oswald had been arrested for the murder of Tippit, the police officer. And this is a picture of me again with my three Leicas and my Leica bits on the bottom with Oswald coming out of the elevator. And this is another frame from movie footage. This is an example of what my camera took. And these pictures of Oswald weren't done with flash. Everybody was using flash and bright lights and this and that. But this, to me, was more of a telling story. Here is a little video of what took place 2-3 hours later.
This is room 317, homicide bureau here at the Dallas Police Station.
And look at, oh, excuse me, I gotta go back. How do I do that? There. Oops. I hit the wrong button here. Okay. Look in the left-hand bottom corner and you'll see something.
Homicide bureau here at the Dallas Police Station. And you see they are bringing the weapon that was allegedly used in the assassination of President John F. Kennedy this afternoon at 12:30 here in Dallas. This is the weapon that was used.
Now look in the left corner, bottom. Now, what this is all about is very, very important. There wasn't one photographer standing behind me. Everybody was on the other side, but I knew, I had trained myself by then, that sometimes a single picture has to tell the entire story. And to me, the story was all the media crushing on the second floor of the Dallas police station. So to me, the silhouette of the gun against the fluorescent lights, seeing all the photographers with their flashes going off. And this picture became a picture that went all over the world and is one of the pictures that's remembered. But I didn't only photograph news events. Buster Keaton. I'd get an assignment to go and photograph the new animals that F.O. Schwartz, the toy store in New York. So what did I do? I took the giraffe to the Brooklyn Zoo, and I put a little honey or something on the giraffe, and all the big giraffes come about. And of course, this picture goes worldwide. Not because of F.O. Schwartz, but just the uniqueness. So what I'm saying is, you've got to figure out how do you make a picture different in those days? Because not every picture is going to be the gun raised in the air. I had an assignment to photograph Lassie, the famous dog. So what do I do with Lassie? I take Frank Innes, his trainer, to an empty street, and I say, show me how you train Lassie. And this is a very iconic picture. I started to cover Edwards Air Force Base out in California. And the B-1, I was photographing the X-15, the first plane to go into space. They allowed me to put a camera inside of it, this and that and everything else. But then the B-1 bomber, the first plane that would fly on its own shockwave, was being developed and was in a hangar at Edwards Air Force Base. And everybody wanted the picture of that plane, but the government didn't want any pictures released of it. I convinced the PR guy at Edwards Air Force Base to allow me to photograph the shadow of the plane. How do you tell a story in a single picture? Again, I didn't have to see the whole plane. And this picture ran all over the place because it continued the mystery while telling you a little bit of the story. At that time, Nikon came out with a camera that was motorized and a battery pack. And Jay Ironman at Life magazine and I were always, we didn't want to lug around these batteries and everything. And we came up with the idea of, could we make a little thing to go under the camera that we could fire the camera remotely, that it didn't have to be in our hands. And we hired Herb Jacobson, who had a machine shop on Vine Street in Hollywood, to make what we called the Remo Pack. And shortly after that, I got an assignment to photograph Hans Keller's deep dive on a submarine 1,000 feet to the continental shelf. So they allowed me to put my remote control camera, this is the first time I ever did it, inside the diving bell. And the idea was to photograph these guys breaking this record on different type of gases to go to the continental shelf. Little did I know that Peter Small in the bottom right-hand corner would lose his life and my camera would record Hans Keller in the foreground and Peter Small, and I'm not showing the frames in which he collapses and, you know, cuddles up and dies. But in those days, where did we put the camera? How do you come up with a picture that isn't like everybody else's? Well, you know, here's my Nikon with the Remo Pack, putting it in the front of an Olympic, putting it under the steeplechase to get an unusual angle. And everybody tried to figure out, where did I put the camera here? Was I in a motorcycle? Was I driving in another car? And they were taking bets at the Saturday Evening Post and Life magazine how this picture was done. Well, it was done very, very simple. I'm sure all of you have seen glass installed in homes and office buildings. How do you carry the glass? With suction cups. So I took a suction cup and I made an L bracket and I suctioned it to the side of the car and I told Hitch to sit in the back seat, and if he could see the lens in the side mirror that we adjusted, then the lens was seeing him. It's called the angle of incidence. And that was when Hitch said, oh, this guy knows something about photography. I'm going to use him a lot. And I got hired by Hitchcock many, many times. I was sitting in the passenger seat with my remote control. But here's an example that you get an assignment to photograph Hitchcock and Tippi Hedren, and you got to come up with something different. But this wasn't enough. It wasn't where I wanted to put a camera. Sometimes I wasn't allowed, so I would have to convince other people to put a camera, even in a 49ers game against San Francisco, against, I think this is the Rams or somebody. I got convinced the referees to put cameras around their waist. And when a play was to start, just hit the button and it started. I had 250 exposure backs. Here again, put a camera where nobody would do. This was part of a story I did for Life magazine on Rod Pack on skydiving. How did I get a camera all the way out there? Some people thought I jumped, but if you know anything about jumping, you know, gravity pulls you, boom, quickly. What I did is on the horizontal stabilizer of the plane, we put a 14-foot aluminum pole, and I counterweighted on one side the weight of the camera on the other side and ran a wire, and I'm in the back seat of the plane. And therefore, when the Rod Pack did this stunt, I just fired it. Again, it's not only the idea, but convincing the pilot and making a test to make sure that the safety and so forth. That wasn't enough. When I got the Reno Air Races, I wanted to show, what is it really like to fly around a pylon? What are the races like? So I convinced one of the pilots we would agree to pay for a new piece of metal to drill a hole right behind the prop in which I put a motorized camera, and I realized there might be a reflection and this and that, again, to come up with. But sometimes I got really in trouble. I was hired to do a fashion story. I'd never shot fashion in my life. And I had to come up with ideas to make the pictures interesting. So I lived near Camp Pendleton, and I convinced the public information officer that on Armed Forces Day, when they would have these public exhibitions, that they could send over one of the landing barges with some Marines, and I would do a shot. So this is the opening picture in 8 pages of fashion that had to do with bathing suits. But how did I get in trouble? Well, you don't think when congressmen saw this on the floor of the House of Representatives, they didn't hold up the magazine and say, is this the way our money is being spent? But again, and then came the Olympic trials in LA, and there were no glass windows in those days in swimming pools, and I convinced the Olympic Committee to allow me to go down with scuba gear and my Hasselblad and to photograph the preliminaries of the water polo in LA for the Olympics. And this became part of a very important series of sports pictures that I was doing. In 1965, I get an assignment to photograph a boxer who's just changed his name from Cassius Clay to Muhammad Ali. So I go to Las Vegas and I photographed Ali knocking out Floyd Patterson. This is the first of 5 fights that I would photograph Ali and travel. I even did a book with him, an entire book in which we hired Wilfred Sheed to write the text. And I had a long relationship. And when he became ill with Parkinson and I started the Mailer Center, he was the 3rd honoree that we gave the Mailer Lifetime Achievement Award, because Mailer had written this great piece about him on the fight that took place in Zaire. But coming back from Las Vegas in 65, 4 days later, we're in the Watts riots. So from a fight in Las Vegas as a photographer, I'm now photographing the devastation of the Watts riots and the deaths that took place. And this is a cover to show you how you shoot and how it winds up. But again, in those days, I started to feel I didn't take pictures like Edward Weston or Ansel Adams or all the great photographic artists. I started to think of my camera as a sponge, that all I was doing was preserving what was in front. But once in a while, you get an assignment, and again, you got to dream up a crazy idea. So I get an assignment to photograph Duke University's coach, and one line in the text I read was that he would take the basketball players around the desk, sit them down like a board meeting, and they would discuss what they were going to do in the game. That's an idea. Now, in those days, we didn't have Photoshop. This is the 60s. This is a double exposure on a 4x5. I did the first picture inside the boardroom with black paper in the center. And then out on the basketball court, I had the cutout of the paper, which I then put on a glass plate in front of the camera, the same distance from the lens to the glass as from the lens to the film, and did the reverse and exposed just the center, and came up with this double exposure, which life ran full page. But also, I had to be a little more tricky, so I wanted to do something a little different. So here's 6 exposures on a 4x5. Each of the basketball players is standing on a piece of plexiglass. You can see it around them. And I'm photographing them on underneath a 6-foot scaffold, and they're on plexiglass. And I'm shooting on the same sheet of film. Every one of these images that you saw before is on the same sheet of film. Now, I shot more than one sheet, maybe 6 or 8, but all 6 of these exposures is on one sheet of film. But as I said, in those days, I started to shoot for Playboy. And I had done a few Playmates. But the big thing that very few people realized was that Magazines existed because they had home subscriptions. Life magazine only sold 3 million copies on the newsstands, but they sold an extra million at home on subscription. And the only way magazines survived was to get special postal rates. People didn't know that if you applied for special postal rates, the post office had the right to review the magazine and to make sure it was fit to be sent through the mails. If you sent a letter with a liberal picture of your girlfriend or your wife or somebody, the post office didn't know. You just sent it through the mail. But in a magazine, the post office had the right to censor. So Hefner had a deal out there. I'll give $25,000 to any photographer who can come up with a picture that I can get through the mail that has frontal nudity. So I was shooting a movie for Universal called Sweet Charity with Shirley MacLaine. And I'd already had a little tiff with Shirley because Life wanted a cover of her and Gwen Verdon. Gwen Verdon was Bob Fosse's wife, who was a great choreographer, as he was, and she had played the role on Broadway. So Life wanted Shirley MacLaine and Gwen Verdon side by side doing the same step. And of course, I made a Polaroid test of that, and I took it to Shirley in her dressing room, and I said, "This is a guaranteed Life cover, Shirley." And she looked at me and she said, "Larry, you're not as smart as I thought you were." I said, "What do you mean?" "They didn't raise the $6 million on Gwen Verdon's name. They raised it on me. You think I'm going to share a Life cover?" Of course, Shirley wound up being alone on Life cover. And there's another story which you'll hear in a minute. So Paula Kelly was in the movie. Beautiful girl, 6'4". And I had seen some art. I'd seen Duchamp's famous painting of the nude descending the staircase. So I was saying, well, if I do a multiple exposure of Paula coming down the stairs with rim lighting, it can have frontal nudity, but it wouldn't be right in your face. So Paula said, "Fine." And we built a whole studio setup. And I made that exposure, and it was horrible. It just didn't work. I couldn't separate the images, et cetera, et cetera. And at the very last minute, I said to Paula, "Let's try the same thing horizontal." I only shot two sheets of film on 4x5 with multiple exposures and strobes. And this is the picture that broke the band with the US Post Office. Hefner paid me $25,000 at that time, which was the largest amount ever paid for a single photograph. Davis Douglas Duncan had gotten $50,000 for his entire set of Picasso. And this broke the ban and put Guccione in business. As you know, Gucci took it 10 miles further. One of the problems I had personally as a photographer, and as you probably saw, all of these things I've shown you were one-offs. An assignment for this or that. And I was dying to do a photographic essay. Nobody would give me a photographic essay. Steve Shapiro went and did civil rights. But for some reason, I was known as the one-off guy. So finally, I convinced Dick Stolle at Life magazine to let me start an essay on the indiscriminate use of the drug LSD, the positive and the negative. And that became, in 1966, the first photographic essay that I ever did in my life, which would show the good and the bad and everything. And this became one of the iconic pictures. I shot most of it in San Francisco, and this is another picture. You can see that these are not one-off images. These are part of an essay. And so forth. And the pictures impressed Timothy Leary and Dick Alpert, better known as Ram Dass, is that Alpert said, let's do a book together. This is, to me, the most important picture in my essay. It's called The Morning After. Because usually you dropped acid late in the afternoon and the evening, you spent the whole evening, and this is the morning after. So I got Ram Dass, Dick Alpert, who's on there, and Sidney Cohn, who is a very conservative from the Wadsworth VA Hospital in LA, to answer. This is the first time I did interviews on tape, 30 questions or 40 questions, and the idea is, without editing, we would publish their answers. Two sides of the fence, two sides of the issue. And this is in my home, in the living room, which never had any furniture, right, Mark? Only a couch. On the other side of the room, the fireplace had furniture, helping to lay out the pictures of the book. This is the Life magazine cover story, and this is the book that I did in 1966 with Dick Alpert, Sidney Cohn. But look at the book. Sold for $1.95. Okay, 128 pages. How many copies do you think we sold? Well, at that time, I had met a guy in publishing by the name of Ned Chase. And he was the editor-in-chief of New American Library, a fine publisher. And I took the idea, the dummy, to him laid out. And he said, I'll publish it. I'll give you an advance. And I said, you're going to do it in hardcover, or how are you going to do it? He says, no, I'm not going to publish it. I'm not going to sell this in bookstores. I said, what do you mean? He says, I'm going to sell this on newsstands. This became what we now call a bookazine, the first bookazine ever done by a major publisher. 6 million copies it sold on newsstands at $1.95. And it was the same audience that had seen the Life magazine cover, and the same type of an audience. I then, having done a big essay and now working with Dick Alpert and Timothy Leary, and I went to his trial in Laredo and so forth, I started to go back and I wanted to try to see if I could interpret sports. And at that time, the only motorized camera besides the Nikon was a camera called the Photon, made by Bell and Howell. And this is a 600 millimeter Kilford lens, or no, 400 millimeter with a monocular. And this in 1968 is an award-winning picture I did of O.J. Simpson breaking the rushing record against UCLA at SC. Simpson, as you'll see, later comes back into my life in a very, very strong way. But I started, and then I started photographing Bobby Kennedy, and I started using long lenses. You know, how do you set up an image that tells a story, again, with a long lens or a wide angle? Bobby, everybody said, was running under the shadow of his brother. How do you illustrate that in a picture? And of course, how do you show that he is as human as all of us? And this is a picture I made flying from South Dakota to LA a week before his life is taken from us, and he's sleeping with the Cocker Spaniel on the floor of the plane. This is the picture that the family and I like the best as we're coming into LA, which appears on Kerry Kennedy's cover of the book. And when they did the memorial, Ed Guthman did, of all the eulogies, this is the picture that was on the title page of Bobby. Then Berry Gordy calls me one day and he says, you photographed Diana Ross in Central Park for the New York Times. I said, yes, I did that. Yeah, we like those pictures. Diana's bringing a young movie, a music group from Detroit to California. And would you mind shooting some pictures? Maybe you can get them in the New York Times. And so I went out to Berry Gordy's house in Beverly Hills. And I said, well, tell me a little bit about it. He says, well, they've never been out of Detroit. I said, have they ever seen an ocean? He says, no. I said, well, that's great. That's what we'll do. We'll take them down to the ocean and let them see the ocean. So this is the first picture done of the Jackson 5 when they came to California before they started really cutting records. And that's Michael on the right side. Two of my kids, with my second wife, we lived in Encino, two blocks away from the Jacksons. So they went to school with Michael's brother's kids. So there was a relationship that kind of continued through the kids. In 1969, as I mentioned before, the studios were well aware that magazine coverage was the most important thing. And if you could syndicate your pictures all over the world, you were worth gold to a motion picture studio. Well, with Marilyn Monroe, I had an agent in London, Tom Blau, Camera Press. Who did he represent? Some unknown photographers, Yusuf Karsh, Cecil Beaton. And again, he didn't have a photographer in Hollywood, so he represented me. So Tom Blau was the one that helped syndicate my Marilyn pictures all over the world. And by then, the studios were paying photographers a lot of money to cover movies. Bob Willoughby was getting $8,000 to $10,000 a week in the late 60s, a lot of money. John Bryson, and I was part of a group that was getting between $8,000 and $10,000. So I got hired by 20th Century Fox to photograph a movie called Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, but they needed an ad to announce the pictures. And I looked through a bunch of tintypes and I came up with this picture of the theme for Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. And I was photographing in Cuautla, Mexico and Durango and traveling with Paul, and I'd shot, you know, five movies with him. And one day I said to Paul, I'm getting tired. I'm photographing different heads on the same bodies. That's exactly what I said to him. And he said, well, why don't you start directing films? I said, nobody's going to hire a photographer to direct a film. Nobody's going to give me that money. They only hire me because I syndicate well. And he threw me the script. Paul Monash, one of the producers, was there, and John Foreman was. Read this and pick a scene that you would want to direct, and I'll tell George Roy Hill you're going to direct it. Because Newman owned the picture. I read the script, and I couldn't find a scene that I felt I could do something with. But I found a mistake in the picture, in the story of an award-winning screenplay by Bill Golden. So I went back to Paul sheepishly, and I said, I got something I can do there, but it may cost you $500,000. Not me, but that's what it'll cost. He says, what's it all about? I said, well, you know, when I covered the Seattle World's Fair in 1962, I was introduced to Charles Ames at the American Pavilion. And I had never seen in my life still photographs animated on what I later found out was a motorized Oxbury that came and made pictures come to life. Ames was the first one to do this in 1962. So I said, the problem with your script is they throw down the bicycle in the West and they're going to Bolivia, and the next scene is the wheel of the bicycle turns into the wheel of the train, and the train is arriving in Bolivia. I said, that's not what happened. People would have to take the train to New York. Boats didn't go to South America every week. You'd have to sit around. Maybe there was the Easter parade. Maybe you'd discover Tiffany's. You know, maybe you'd go to Central Park. I said, we should do a montage of still images. He said, well, how are you going to make the still images come alive? So he allowed me to make a test. This is the image that I made a test. Nothing's spinning in this picture. That's two pieces of 12 by 12 plywood that has these lines painted. And the actors are just pretending that they're swimming around. But you look at that picture and you think it's really turning. And when Newman and John Foreman saw this, they said, all right, they went to Richard Zanuck and they said, let Larry storyboard. They got a sketch artist. I storyboarded all the ideas. And then I realized I didn't have an editor yet. So I called Charles Ames's office and they gave me the name of the editor that in 1962 had worked on the American Pavilion. And this is the montage which changed my life from being a photographer to many other things. This is the way the script was. And now they're in Bolivia. Now, it's kind of, thank you. By today's standards, it's a little boring to me because the technology has advanced so much, as you'll see. But what happened in Hollywood is all the studios saw this and nobody realized it was actually shot with stills and the images of the actors were shot against seamless paper and then cut and pasted and airbrushed in old photographs. They thought it was scenes that had been collapsed. So I started to get assignments and offers from major studios to direct things that I knew nothing about and couldn't know how to direct. Of course, the end of Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid becomes very famous. But I had another assignment, and I couldn't accept some of these studios. And I had an assignment to photograph Barbara Streisand. And she was working in LA and London, and we traveled to Brighton in England. And Yves Montand was starring with her, so I get an assignment, again from Life magazine. We want you to do Streisand and Montand for the cover of Life. So I set up in the studio on the set, some stand-ins, I make a Polaroid. I take it to Barbara, and I say, here's the cover of Life, guaranteed cover. And she looks at me and she says, I'm now thoroughly convinced you're the stupidest photographer I've ever worked with. What's wrong? Howard Koch told me that you were so brilliant. He was the executive producer, vice president of Paramount. But don't you realize that a picture, if I'm going to waste my time, of me and Montand on the cover of Life magazine, the movie, when this movie's over, it's going to become an old picture. But a picture of me alone, you'll always sell, Larry. And she was right. This became the cover of Life magazine. And this picture was premiered years later at Cannes with Barbara there and so forth. This is a picture I did of her at 2 o'clock in the morning after we were editing pictures in the Plaza Hotel with very little makeup, sitting on the edge, bouncing a couple strobes. And it's one of Barbara's favorites and some of mine. And this is just the simple Barbara. Paramount Pictures called me while I was on this movie. And they said, we have a movie that's 4 hours long. We made it like The Godfather. Bob Evans was the one who called. And we want to cut it to 2 hours, and the producer won't do it. And the director won't do it, he gave us the picture. And you collapsed Butch Cassidy with that montage. You took all those scenes out. We'd like you to do the same thing. And I said, let me see the film. So I went, and Eddie Sieta showed me the film, 4 hours. And then they took me to the producer, whose desk was on a little riser, and a young man behind him was combing his hair, which I later find out was his son. And Mr. Gordy, Barry Gordy, says, well, what did you think of the film? And I said, well, the problem with the film is you have so many orgasms with no foreplay. You're going from great scene to great scene to great scene. And the story of Billie Holiday, the most important person in her life was not the guy who turned her on to drugs, but Count Basie, and Count Basie isn't even in the film. And Berry Gordy said, well, I'm not making a film about Count Basie and Billie Holiday. I'm making a film about a white man turning a black entertainer on to drugs. I said, well, you think you're going to sell tickets that way? I said, I know what to do with this film. I said, I got to cut it. I got to direct new scenes. I was now having a little more confidence that I could direct. And I worked a year and 3 months for Berry Gordy. There were many versions of the film. We took it down to 2 hours and 10 minutes. And then I discovered when we got it down that there was a major, major problem with the film. We premiered it in Cleveland, I think it was, the audience, and the film started at that time with her scrubbing the floor in a place with prostitutes, and she's like an 18-year-old girl. And I said, you know, everybody thinks of Diana Ross as this great glamorous person. An audience is not going to be ready when they sit down to see her as a 12-year-old scrubbing floors. I said, we have to wipe out of their mind the Diana Ross of today and place them in the period. And he said, well, how would you do that? And I said, well, I'd shoot a title sequence. And he says, well, we have titles for the movie. I said, no. I'd like to take my 16 millimeter Eclair camera, and if I could have one day with Diana, makeup and hair and so forth, Barry. And he gave me the one day, and I'll show you the product of the one day. And he loved it so much that he gave me a credit in the main titles, which said that the titles, and the sequences and the montages were not only created by me, but were executed. And of course, that started my whole motion picture career. So let me see here how I start this. There. So this is the opening title sequence, which didn't exist in the script. See, it's still photographer, still thinking. But look what I do now. I start to mix motion with the freeze frame. I did this at LA County Jail in about 3 hours. And that's when Barry gave me my gift of the credit. And that was my idea on how to de-glamorize Diana Ross. And it was very, very successful. And it allowed me to start to make my own films after this. Another call I got was a gentleman by the name of Budge Crowley in Canada, who had a piece of film that was done by David Wolper of an Olympic skier, Yoshika Mira, who had skied down the South Pole of Mount Everest and had slid on ice 5,000 feet, and his parachute had grabbed onto a rock and saved his life. And he said, well, you did this thing for Berry Gordy and you did this. How do we make a film out of this 3-5 minutes of film? So again, I was photographing Paint Your Wagon, still taking pictures once in a while. And I was with Alan J. Lerner, and I told him about this guy who climbed Mount Everest, and I got to make a film. And I said, you know, I think it's got to have voiceover narration as he tells the story. And Alan J. Lerner said, go read The Little Prince, and that will be your voiceover narration. Have it written like that. And Alan J. Lerner gave me the idea. And what I did is I storyboarded the entire story that I wanted to tell, from Kathmandu to Jambesi Pass to Everest and everything. But none of that footage existed. So I went and got the original cameraman who had photographed for David Wilbur. The original, we were able to track down from the film reports, the lab number, the lens numbers, the camera numbers. And by storyboard, we went a little bit to Kathmandu and Everest, to Jambesi Pass, but then we went to Mount Fuji in Japan, and we shot the entire story, except for that little piece. The entire story was made up. We had Sherpas that were dressed up, and we had them watching Bonanza, you know, and this and that for laughs. And the film is done, and we show it. A year goes by, Budge Crowley doesn't release it. 2 years go by, he doesn't release it. The third year, I call his wife, and I say, why isn't he releasing it? Larry, let him do the distribution. You're the filmmaker. So why isn't he distributing it? He's waiting for the competition to be right so he can win the Oscar. And he was waiting and analyzing every year the competition. And of course, this won the Oscar for best feature-length documentary. And I received the credit as the editorial director because I didn't direct the key piece of film of him dropping down. Then, as a film you'll see here, the second, or the real first documentary I made was Kit Carson, a friend of mine that I had met. I had an idea to do a documentary on Paul Newman that Paul didn't like. My idea was of an actor who submerges himself in the myth of his character. Because when Paul finished Butch Cassidy, for about a year, you thought you were looking at Butch Cassidy, not Paul Newman. So we went to the idea, Kit and I, with Dennis. And we said, Dennis, this is the idea of you as an actor submerging yourself in the character from Easy Rider. And he said, well, that's possible, but then I have to act. And he says, I got it. We'll make a picture of an actor playing an actor in a documentary that's being made about him. And every single scene we'll discuss in the morning, and I will act out, but nobody else in the film will know that I'm acting it out. They'll think that it's real because I'm a good actor. That's exactly what Dennis said. And that's what we basically did. And when we finished the film, I realized again I had a problem with the opening. How do you get into some guy's life? How do you just jump in and say, I'm now going to peel all the layers of the onion back? And one day I got up and I called Kit. And I said, Kit, why don't we just knock on Dennis's door and film it? And Kit says, well, we better tell Dennis what we're doing so he can act it out. So here's the opening of the film based on how do you get into somebody's life.
In church, yeah. You know, I smoke grass and I drop occasionally. I do those things. Whatever that means, and whoever hates me for that, terrific, and whoever loves me for it, terrific.
Now you'll see the actor.
You
go in a corner and not think about it right there for 5 minutes. It's impossible. Because you go in the corner and you already are saying, I'm not going to think about it right there. Oh, shit, I felt nothing right there. You know, you can't do it.
Just act natural.
Just act natural?
Just
act natural. Just
I think so, yeah.
That's an example. That scene was actually shot about 7 times. And that's Dennis acting out a concept. And that is the beginning of a film, which some of you may go see, which is a complete documentary, except the lead character is acting every minute of it. About the same time became the 10th anniversary of the tragedy and the death of Marilyn. And I got 24 of the world's greatest photographers together to do a book on Marilyn Monroe. Everybody from Milton Greene to Richard Avedon to Helmut Newton, you name it, Cecil Beaton, Larry Shore. And this is a book that we did, which sold extremely well. And I hired, through the publisher, Norman Mailer, to write a 15,000-word introduction. And Norman didn't write 15,000 words. He wrote 95,000 words. Try to cut Norman Mailer's 95,000 words. Well, the idea was, now how do I get this book on the cover of Life, the cover of Time, and everything? Because originally, believe it or not, I wanted Gloria Steinem to write the text, who many years later, and I have the notes still in my archive of me writing to Gloria and so forth, and she felt it wasn't for her. Because what I wanted was controversy. Steinem writing about Marilyn was as controversial as Norman writing about Marilyn Monroe, this male chauvinist pig, Norman Mailer, who every feminist in the U.S. just hated. His legendary discussions with, you know, Green and various people. So I really wanted the cover of Time magazine. And I had an art director who used to work for Look, who was living in California. And we came up with an idea that Marilyn was more powerful than Mailer, and that she was playing with him, even though his words were playing with her. So we sketched a cover of Time magazine. And believe it or not, we just put it in the mail to the picture editor at Time magazine. Because in those days, Time magazine did all their own covers. Nobody could ever do a cover. And one day I get a phone call from the picture department at Time magazine. Where do we get the color transparency of Marilyn and the black and white of Norman? You see, the original guy that Marilyn was playing with was Yves Montand. So we took Montand out and put Norman in. And when Norman saw the cover, he called me up and he says, "Larry, I'm never going to work with you again." I said, "What's wrong? You got the cover of Time magazine. And next week we got the cover of Life." He says, "With that cover, I'll never win the Nobel Prize for Literature." Of course, Norman and I did 5 books together. Shortly thereafter, Patty Hearst. And then one day I read in the LA Times of a young girl who had attempted to take her life, and at the bedside was her 2 children that were under 3 years of age, and she had overdosed on purpose to take her life. And that her boyfriend, who was a convict sentenced to be executed, had attempted suicide at the same time. And immediately in my mind, I said, how could somebody be so evil to convince a girl to take her life, and she didn't even take her 2 children and give it children to her mother to watch or the neighbor? I said, I have to go to Salt Lake City and do this story. Eventually, you'll see, I spent 1.5 years interviewing 157 people, acquired the rights directly, but I'm going to show you one of the opening scenes from the award-winning film I made with Tommy Lee Jones, who played Gilmore, called The Executioner Song. But this little clip, which is from the film, really tells you a lot about Larry Schiller. That I wasn't really a photographer, but I was more of a salesman. This is actual Provo, Utah. Can you make it a little louder?
Okay. Gilmore's okay with no recall. This senior little guy comes out of prison, struggles with old con habits, and he's killing him. On the other hand, if we get the girl but we can't sign Gilmore, then we focus the whole thing completely on Nicole. I mean, here's a study of an adolescent saddled with children who falls in love with a criminal. I am sure that the two cheat happens. And I want the network to back me in a real way. I want to be able to get in there and deal for this property. Everybody's here. The stamp is on the meat. I'm prepared to offer you a total of $75,000 for all rents, of which Nicole will get a third. In effect, I'm offering Gary $50,000. This is a firm offer, Mr. DeVico. This is not a bargaining stance. These are the real prices that are available. Other producers eventually may tell you the property may be worth $10 million. Watch them only offer a small amount now. The likelihood is, the big piece will never be seen.
Mr. Susskind called me from New York. He said the difference between him and you is the difference between a high school football team and the Dallas Cowboys.
Mr. Susskind is right. He is equal to the Dallas Cowboys, and in his eyes, they may be just a high school football team. But I'm here, Mr. All suited up, ready to play. Where are the Dallas Cowboys? They're not even in the stadium. I'm listening.
So that gave me the exclusive rights I acquired. I not only interviewed Gilmore in prison up to the day he was executed, through his lawyers directly on phone conversations. I witnessed the execution. This is Gary an hour before he was executed, taken by one of the prison guards with a camera that I gave. This is me holding the press conference after his execution and the other media. These are some of the 150 some odd tapes for over a year that I interviewed everybody connected with his life. And then I went back to Norman and asked him if he would write the book. And he and I collaborated. I went to Tommy Lee Jones, whether he would star in the film. And the book won the Pulitzer Prize, and the film won 4 Emmys, and gave NBC the highest ratings they had had in a motion picture miniseries. It was 4 hours. And I got an email from Brandon Tartikoff, the head of NBC at that time, a one-line email. What's next? Well, something very interesting happened. Everything I had done in my life had been based on reality. Something I experienced or something that took place in a contemporary period while I was alive. And I decided to tackle something which I knew nothing about. But the challenge was not the story. The challenge was to do a film where no Western company had ever been allowed to do the film since 1918. And I acquired the rights to Robert Massey's book, Peter the Great. And I went to Max Schell, Vanessa Redgrave, Laurence Olivier. And then I went and saw Arm & Hammer, who I had read was in the pencil manufacturing business as a young man in Russia and knew all the Russian people. And he gave me advice on how to deal with the Soviets in those days. And I made the first independent film ever made in the Soviet Union. I started with Brezhnev, wound up with Cherminko, and one day while I was having lunch with Andropov in the home of a very famous Russian writer, I said to him, I want to thank you for the Central Committee allowing me to make this film. I was bringing 111 people in from England. I brought Vittorio Storaro, the great cinematographer, and he looked at me and he said, the word trust doesn't exist in my dictionary. That was through a translator. He says, but I've decided to gamble with you. So I made the film under Andropov, and it was released under Gorbachev. And then I was invited with one of the 1,000 people from all over the world that was invited to the Kremlin when Gorbachev announced Perestroika. And I was sitting maybe 20, 30 feet from Sakharov, and there were all these people. And that afternoon, they had a dinner in the central hall at the Kremlin for everybody that Gorbachev had invited. Each table had 10 people, and the tables just went forever. There's 1,000 people. But when I walked in, I saw there was no chairs by any of the tables. And the tables were all this height. And as we went up to the table that we were assigned, each person had their own waiter. So there was over 1,000 waiters that would come with the food. And each table had a translator. So I asked the translator, why are we standing to eat? And she said, well, when President Gorbachev comes in, he doesn't like people to get up and stand to shake his hand and then sit down. He wants them already to be standing so he can just shake their hands. And when Gorbachev came to the table, I said to him, Mr. President, I thank you for the honor of inviting me. Obviously, you have seen part of Peter the Great, or know of it, or been told. And he said, oh, yes. Yes, I saw the first 2 hours. And he said, there's nothing in the film that we're ashamed of. That was it. That was how he characterized the film. 2 years, 3 years later, I get a phone call in the middle of the night from a friend of mine by the name of Robert Kardashian. You all know the Kardashians. And Robert says, on the news in a few minutes, Nicole has been killed and OJ is in Chicago, and we got to get some lawyers and so forth, et cetera, et cetera. And I don't know, he wants to hide out at my house when he comes back. So I met Robert by the 405 freeway to give him some advice on how to deal with the media. First thing I said to him is the word no comment is a comment. The short and long of it, Robert said to me, you know, OJ has no money. He's got $200,000 in the bank. He owns condos, he owns homes, this, that, but he's got no cash. And Shapiro wants $1.5 million. I don't know how to get the $1.5 million. I can't get a second mortgage on any of the property because he may go to jail. And OJ was getting all these letters in jail, you may remember. And there were boxes and bags of letters in Kardashian's house. So I walked in one day and I said, what do you mean you don't have money? You got $5 million laying right here by the door. He says, what do you mean? I said, well, in those envelopes is all the money for the defense. He says, no, we open the envelope. Sometimes there's a $5 bill. Sometimes it's a Bible. There are even some knives we found. I said, no. You get me in to interview O.J. in jail, and we will publish a book with him answering all these letters. And I interviewed O.J. Only one of his attorneys knew. Shapiro didn't even know. For 16 hours, I hired Dave Johnson, who had won a Pulitzer from the newspaper, to help me edit the interviews that I had done on O.J. The first question I asked him when I interviewed him in jail was Nicole a good mother? I wasn't interested in the murder or the violence. I was interested in what life was like. And Dave Johnson, Pulitzer Prize winning reporter, took all the letters and broke them down by subject index. You know, this deals with religion, this deals with violence. And I interviewed him, and we published this book, which virtually paid for the entire defense. When O.J. was released and found innocent, based on Mark Furman really destroying the case for the prosecution, I had the exclusivity to O.J., and these are some images done. And this is my favorite picture because O.J. will be in a prison for the rest of his life. But during that whole year and a half, I was able to write my own book. And I asked James Woolworth of Time Magazine, who was in court every day, and I was with the defense and Robert and everything, interviewing everybody during the trial. And Woolworth wrote about what took place inside. I wrote about what took place in the defense. And the book became, obviously, a number one New York Times bestseller. And I made it into a motion picture with William Hurt, which again won a lot of awards. But I'm going to end the talk going back to my dyslexia, because all of this is really based upon insecurity. Exclusivity, all of that is because I always felt insecure because I couldn't read, I couldn't write, I couldn't spell. I mean, when Microsoft Word came in, that was a godsend. And then when Alexa comes in, Alexa, how do you spell this? Alexa, how do you spell that? I don't know that word. Then I put it in a sentence, and Alexa spells every word in the sentence for me. But one day I'm having lunch with Tina Brown, who's now the editor-in-chief of The New Yorker. And she says, you know, Larry, everything you do really sells and this and that. I want you to do a cover story for The New Yorker. I want you to write it. I said, come on, Tina, you know I can't write. I can dictate a story, and I can tell the story, but I'm not a writer. And she looks at me and says, don't worry, I'm giving you Gore Vidal's editor. And of course, I wound up with a byline on the cover, Why the DA Hasn't Indicted JonBenet Ramsey's Parents by Lawrence Schiller. And that was the first story of several that I wrote. I'm going to end the talk by telling you the irony in parts of my life. I showed you what took place at Kennedy's assassination. What I didn't go into detail, because I'm already going too long in this talk, is that I built a relationship with Marina Oswald. And she used to write letters to my second wife, Stephanie. And she even came to California with her kids to spend time with my kids. And Mark, my son here, faintly remembers one of her trips. And I was very, very close to Marina, helping her solve some of her problems in life. And Norman and I eventually went to Belarus and brought Marina's aunt and did a book called Oswald's Tale about Oswald's years in the Soviet Union. But that was really based upon Marina opening the doors to everybody in Minsk. The irony of that, with that relationship, when it came to the centennial of JFK in 2017, in 2015, I get a phone call from Stephen Kennedy Smith and Caroline Kennedy's attorney in Boston. Mr. Schiller, we have a book of JFK speeches that we want to publish, and we need some photographs to go with it. And they send me the book, and I look at the book, and I call up Stephen Kennedy, and I said, Stephen, you have a problem. This book's going to sell 3,000 copies. You can make it sell 40,000 or 100,000 if you really want to make it into a book. And he says, well, what would you do? I said, I would take every speech and find somebody that could write 250 words about that speech. And the first person I said to Stephen was, let's get Koki Oman from the United Nations to write about Kennedy's speech on immigration. And he says, well, how are we going to get to all these people? I said, everybody's going to return Caroline's phone call. And that's exactly what I did. And those are the names of everybody from Henry Louis Gates to Gloria Steinem to you name it who wrote the introductions. Costco alone ordered 10,000 copies and eventually sold 30,000 copies, just Costco alone. And while we're doing the book, I had hired a designer who designed this contemporary image of JFK. Because how do you bring JFK into the 21st century? And you need an image that is not history, but has a little bit of movement and feeling. So the designer worked with me and Nina, my wife at that time, and we designed this. And then I said, just before the book was going to be published, I said, why aren't we taking all these pictures and exhibiting them in the Smithsonian or someplace? And Susan Bloom, a friend who worked with me on Annie Leibovitz, picked up the phone and called the Smithsonian. And the Smithsonian American Art Museum allowed me to curate the exhibition for the centennial of JFK. This is opening night at the Smithsonian, and this is Caroline introducing me. What am I doing now? I'm doing Bobby Kennedy's centennial for 2 years from now. What's my idea on Bobby Kennedy? Because everybody in his life has passed on. But I'm getting Martin Luther King's son to write about what his father told him about Bobby Kennedy. Chavez's son from the farm workers, his son, or I think it's a daughter, to write about what her father told her about Bobby Kennedy. And that's what the book is going to be about. Not only Bobby, but what the children of the people that Bobby knew remember that their parents. So this is Larry Schiller, who started as a photographer, and now always runs a little long on his speeches. Thank you.